All right, good morning, church. Good morning, Amy Kern. Brothers and sisters, welcome. We're so glad that you're here today. We're going to begin our service this morning hearing from the word of the Lord. This is Psalm number 24. Heather had gum in her mouth. Okay, all right.
Are you ready? No, I know that.
All right. Okay. All right, here we go.
The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world, and those who live in it. For he has founded on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place?
Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully.
They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek face, the God of Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is the King of glory?
The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle.
Lift up your head, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory?
The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory.
Praise be to God for his word.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Heather. Thank you, church. Let's stand together as we praise this great King, the King of glory, the Lord of hosts. There's a reason why the curse of sin is broken. There's a reason why the darkness runs from light. There's a reason that we stand here now forgiven. Jesus is alive. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's praise him. There's a reason why we are not overtaken. There's a reason why we sing on through the night. There's a reason why our hope remains eternal. Jesus is alive. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the King. Praise the King, he is risen. Praise the King, he's alive. Praise the King, death's defeated. Hallelujah, he's alive. We sing, hallelujah, he's alive. There's a reason why our hearts can be courageous. And there's a reason why the dead are made alive. There's a reason why we share his resurrection. Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, praise the King.
Glory to God. God forever.
Amen. Church, I ask you a question. Is he worthy? Amen. He is. Would you turn and greet one another in the Lord this morning? Thank you, church.
All righty, let's head back to our seats for just a moment. Children, on your way back to your seats, you could be dismissed to Children's Church back there in the back. We've got some volunteers. Miss Emily is waving her hands back there in the back. You guys can head back that way. Church, we are so glad that you're here with us this morning. A little extra hour of sleep does the body good, yes, amen. And so thank you for being here with us this morning. If you're a guest with us, thank you for being here. We have a guest information card in the pew back in front of you. And so if you're a guest, we would love for you just to get some simple information from you. We would love to contact with you about what God is doing here at Waterloo and with our church family. And so if you're a guest, man, take just a couple seconds to do that. You could place that in the offering plate at the end of our service. We'd love that information from you. Church family, as you are here this morning, this card is also for you. We ask week in and week out for prayer requests and things that we can be praying for you as a church family, as a staff. And so if there is a prayer need that you have this week that you'd like to inform us about, would you use that back of that card to write that down? And we'd love to pray for you this week. Let me pray for us as a church, and we'll prepare our hearts for the Lord's message this morning. Lord, we love you, and we're so thankful to be in your house of worship. Father, as we prayed earlier, we've been in this pew, we've been in this church time and time again, expectant to hear from you. Lord, we're asking that you would speak to us again. We're asking that you would do it again. Father, use our brother Griff this morning as he is prepared this week to present your word. Help us to listen intensely and intently, Lord, that you would use it to further your kingdom into our hearts for those around us. Lord, we love you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning to you. I want to ask you to open your Bibles to the book of Philemon this morning, the book of Philemon. Some of you are struggling with that right now, so if you find Hebrews, go to the left just a little bit. It's just one page, maybe two at the most, and so you will find that. Good to meet our guests today. We continue to have people from many states and many towns move to this community and area, and we welcome you to Waterloo Road Baptist Church. We had a larger crowd in our early service today. Some people might have forgot, or some people might have wanted to save their hour for this afternoon, right? But we are glad that you joined us here. As you're turning, let me remind you of your incredible privilege and obligation to vote this coming Tuesday. I ask you to do two very important things. You pray, you seek God's will, and you investigate the people and the questions, and you vote according to God's Word and God's will that He directs you to, and give Him the glory as we do in all things. I'll be kind of glad when all those commercials are over, okay? I get to the point of thinking, is there ever a good person in this world anymore, you know? It's like, I just go stare at my grandson then, and I feel better about life then, right? So, Book of Philemon, the second week on a one-chapter book. Last week, we reviewed the overview of the book. Let me give it to you in a short synopsis. There are four main characters. There's one main character, but three other characters. One of the characters is Paul, who was killed Christians and then was saved on the road to Damascus, wrote around one-third of the New Testament. Okay, he wrote this book to his buddy Philemon, who he also had led to the Lord somewhere on one of his missionary journeys. He knew him from the church of Colossae. Philemon was not the head of that church, but they met in his house along with his wife and his, in all likelihood, his son. They were very influential. They were very wealthy. He had a slave, person number three, by the name of Onesimus. And Onesimus had done something wrong against Philemon. I believe he stole from Philemon. He ran away. Somehow he got 1,000 miles away from Colossae to the town of Rome. And somehow he found out about Paul. Maybe he had an acquaintance with Paul. Maybe not. But there, Onesimus became a believer in Christ Jesus. So Paul got to lead his buddy Philemon to the Lord. And then Onesimus, Philemon's slave, had ran away, stole money. Paul got to lead him to Jesus. And now Paul, remember the theme last week? It's like, how did I get in this situation? He's kind of in the between this situation of trying to get these two Christian brothers' relationship right. But then there's a fourth character, and I said the main character in this story. And the main character in this story, as is all the stories of the Bible, is our Heavenly Father God who sent His Son Jesus. And Jesus came down and saved Paul on the road to Damascus and used Paul to share the gospel with Philemon. And then had Onesimus travel 1,000 miles away while Paul was in prison in God's sovereignty. And he came to know Jesus. And so through this whole story of tension and this whole story of friends and masters and slaves, Jesus had it under control. So one thing I just want to remind us of today is when life looks really like crummy, like, wow, how do we get in this mess? Just realize God is still in control. He still got it. He still is faithful, and he's still going to make good come out of this situation. But today, I want to take this whole book of 25 verses, and I want to sum it up into just one theme statement, and I want us to drill deep into this theme statement. To be honest with you today, I'm going to jump around from 25 verses, say look at this verse and look at this verse to kind of point out several things. But let's begin in verse 4 today and just review as we read verses 4 through 17. I'll tell you what, I'm going to pray first and then read that this morning. God, I pray as we read this scripture. And Lord, as I preach, Lord, I pray once again that I don't try to impress, that I don't try to sound good, that I don't try to make some point that is my agenda. God, I pray that your spirit just overrides all of that and you speak through me. But God, I also know you don't even need me. As we sang earlier, we just want to bring glory to you, God. So you just, your glory shine right now and you please do a great work. May we hear well and may this change us, God. May your word change us through the power of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In your name we pray. Amen. Beginning in verse 4, you remember that Paul wrote a great appreciation to Philemon. He says, I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers because I hear of your love and faith toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. I pray your participation in the faith may become effective through knowing every good thing that is in us for the glory of Christ. For I have great joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. He's really sharing how much he appreciates and is thankful for Philemon. For this reason, verse 8 says, although I have great boldness in Christ to command you to do what is right, I appeal to you instead on the basis of love. I, Paul, as an elderly man and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus, appeal to you for my son Onesimus. I fathered him while I was in chains. Once he was useless to you, but now he's useful both to you and to me. I am sending him back to you as a part of myself. I wanted to keep him with me so that in my imprisonment for the gospel, he might serve me in your place. But I didn't want to do anything without your consent, so that your good deed might not be out of obligation, but out of your own free will. For perhaps this is why he was separated from you for a brief time, so that you might get him back permanently, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a dearly loved brother. He is especially so to me, but even more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. And then verse 17. So if you consider me a partner, accept him as you would me. You recall last week we shared together that the book of Philemon is the most personal book in the Bible. Okay, it is written from one man to a good friend. And much like if you wrote a note to a good friend or you sent somebody a text or you sent somebody an email or you called them up on the phone and you were just talking to them and you had some important things to share with them, some things that were on your heart. There's a situation you wanted to give them wisdom on, advice on. You wanted to show that you cared for them. This is that kind of book. And we're honored to have it in God's Word to help us to know what the heart of Paul was as he shared with his two brothers in Christ, Philemon and Onesimus. Now, there's a lot of great points we could talk about in the theme of Philemon, but I want to give you the one theme that resounds throughout this book, and that is that we are all equal in the eyes of the Lord. Paul is saying to Philemon, Onesimus, and himself, and to others, that no matter who we are, no matter what our role is in life, we are all equal in the eyes of the Lord. Verse 13 through 16, he talks about slavery, and I want us to talk about that a little bit. Let's review those verses. I wanted to keep him with me so that in my imprisonment for the gospel, Onesimus might serve Paul in your place. But I didn't want to do anything without your consent, so your good deed might not be out of obligation, but of your own free will. For perhaps this is why he was separated from you for a brief time, so you might get him back permanently, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a dearly loved brother. He is especially so to me, but even more to you, both in the flesh and the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, Paul says, accept him as you would me. Onesimus was a slave to Philemon. Now, slavery in New Testament days was much different from what we would understand it to be in American history. For one thing, Roman slaves were even taken as the spoils of war. In other words, they overcame a country and they brought back prisoners of wars who would serve them as slaves. Or much more often, individuals sold themselves into slavery. I will become your slave for a certain amount of time. They were often well educated. The normal Greek word here was doulo. It's a term that in earlier centuries referred to one who sold themselves into slavery. So when the word doulo is like, okay, that person said, the best thing I can do is to sell myself to this person. Most of the time in the Roman Empire, slaves were freed at age 30 or after 7 years of service. Now, occasionally they were beaten, but that was more rare than normal, much different than in our American, sadly, in our American history. Masters generally showed slaves respect. They treated them with human dignity. They could marry. They could accumulate wealth. And they eventually could be free. Sometimes people will ask the question, especially those who don't have faith in Jesus Christ or those who are trying to say the Bible is antiquated or you can't take it literally. It says, doesn't the Bible promote slavery? And I don't think that is true. I think it's important that we understand who Paul's audience was here. Paul was speaking to Christians. He wasn't speaking to the government. He wasn't trying to get the government to change. He was speaking to Christians. And it would have been meaningless if he was writing that to the government leaders, because they wouldn't have been reading these books. Lost masters who are not believers, were not reading this book. It was meaningless. Paul wasn't going to mention that the Christian slaves should strike, because Paul's great strike, meaning walk away from the job, because Paul's greatest purpose was that all men would come to know Jesus. So he was going to say it's better to be a slave, a Christian slave, to a lost master and to show Jesus than it is to walk away from being a slave. Now, that's what the Bible tells us in all situations, except when it comes down to, are you going to follow Jesus or are you going to follow the world? Are you going to follow Caesar or are you going to follow God? Then it is God's first. But in other situations, we are to take sacrifice. We're supposed to take persecution to show the gospel witness. That's why there's persecution in the world today. One of the reasons. Paul was sharing with Christian masters and with Christian slaves and how they should treat each other. Paul shares in Ephesians 6 that Christian masters should respect their slaves. Okay, that was a radical statement. Please understand that the Roman government at this time would have said that Onesimus at least would have been thrown into prison, could have quite often been killed, and if not, he would have been branded with a letter on his forehead that would mean fugitive. So for Paul to share to Onesimus, to Philemon to take Onesimus back as a brother was a radical statement. Was an incredible statement, was something that so went against society that it wouldn't have made sense to even to believers. But that is what he did. I can't emphasize enough what a radical statement it is of Onesimus no longer being a slave to Philemon, as verse 16 says, but now a dearly loved brother. Paul first emphasized salvation, and that was willing to sacrifice for the cause of salvation, because that's who his audience was. And then he also emphasized how masters and slaves should treat each other as our believers. But by no means did I think that Paul was this proponent of slavery, how American history would teach it. Obviously, that is not the testimony of Paul nor the testimony of God's Word. His main theme here is we are all equal in the eyes of the Lord. So let's go back and just jump around at a few verses just throughout these 25 verses. First of all, look at verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and our co-worker. Okay, Paul was calling him an equal in verse 1. Look at verse 12. He is talking about Onesimus here as he's writing to Philemon. I am sending him back to you as a part of myself. This slave is linked to me now. Verse 16 says, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a dearly loved brother. He's especially so to me, but even more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. He said, hey, we are now equals, not only in the flesh, but also in the Lord. Verse 1, verse 12, verse 16, verse 17 tells us that we are all equal in the Lord. Since we're all equal in the Lord, that also means that we should relate well to each other. We're all equal in the Lord means that we should have koinonia fellowship. Verses 4 through 7, I read earlier to you, but that was where Paul was just telling Philemon of his great thanks. I'm thankful for you. I hear of your love. I pray that your participation in the gospel will, in the faith, will be effective. I have great joy and encouragement because of you. He shares that. Verse 20 and 21, he gives thanks also when he says, yes, brother, may I have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Since I am confident of your obedience, I am writing you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. So when Paul says we're all equal in the Lord, he also means that we all should have fellowship with one another in the Lord. That we share equal in our relationship of grace and of mercy from our one God. That therefore, since we share equal in our vertical relationship with God, we should share equally in our horizontal relationship with God. We should have fellowship with one another. We should have peace with one another. We should have grace and mercy with one another. But here's the difference about Paul. It can be not a difference for pastors or other teachers, but for Paul, and it should be a difference for all of us, for Paul, this experience of koinonia fellowship is not something to think about, but something to do. It's not something to have a good discussion over. Yeah, we need to treat all Christians right. We need to treat all people equal. Yeah, we really ought to do that. That's a good discussion. That's a good thing to do in a small group class. That's a good thing to do in discussion with fellow Christians. But James says to be doers of the word and not hearers only. And Paul was a doer of the word. He brings to Onesimus and to Philemon, and he says, hey, you guys are brothers in Christ, but your relationship is not good. And then he says just strongly to Philemon, man, I know what this guy did to you. He wronged you. It was wrong. But now, he is a new person. But now, he is a new creation. But now, he's not your property. He's a brother in Christ. We're all equals. There is unresolved conflict, and it must be reconciled. Friends, that's a good point for us here today as believers, as a church that has peace and unity to a strong element. May I encourage you that God continues to remind us that we are all equals at the foot of the cross. We're all saved by the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, and we should all give that grace and mercy to others in the name of Jesus Christ. We must be willing to forgive and to ask forgiveness. Paul had a relationship with Philemon, and he went for it. He shared truth. It was a radical request. It was a tall order. Once again, Roman law would have punished him, said prison, perhaps even death. But instead, he was called to forgive him, to welcome him back, to not just welcome him back as somebody, to welcome him back as an equal, to welcome back into Colossae as a family member. Now get this. When somebody takes something from you, other people knows what's going on. There's some social order there. Man, that guy's slave stole for him. Man, that guy could be killed. You know, what a terrible thing. And then one day he's asking that Onesimus shows back up, and Philemon's putting his arm around him and loving him as a Christian brother. I mean, people are going to be going, what is going on? But that is what Paul is calling us to do as believers. You've heard it said, love your friend and hate your enemy. But Jesus said, but I say to you, love your enemy too. You've heard it said that you should go a mile for your enemy, but for your friend, but I want to tell you, go 2 miles for your enemy. Show them love, show them kindness, show them forgiveness. We're all equals at the foot of the cross. Look back at the book of 2 Corinthians. Keep your hand in Philemon, okay? Because it's only one page and it's going to be hard to find again if you don't, okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It'll come up on the screen, but I want you to find it in your copy of God's Word. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Actually, 17, 18, and 19. There's a Bible right in front of you. If you don't have one, if you need to take that, you take that and use it. Use it for the glory of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. What Paul is talking here is as believers, we should be reconciled to one another. We are equal at the foot of the cross. There's not a better Christian and a lesser Christian. Paul is saying that we must be radical. And where did he get this from? He got it from Jesus. Look at verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, in other words, he's all in. He's a believer in Christ. He's saved. He's been rescued. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. And look, new things have come. Onesimus, old things, they've been passed away. New things have come. He's now a believer. Verse 18, everything is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So not only are we reconciled, but church, we also now have the ministry of reconciliation. We're able to show Jesus through us reconciling. That's what he was calling Philemon to do, was to reconcile. Verse 19, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. Paul is telling Philemon to live out 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. To live out being a minister of reconciliation. We have been reconciled in Christ. And now, buddy, you need to love this other guy in Christ. I know it's hard. I know it's difficult. I know it's not natural. But you are called to love him. Would you do one more? Find the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. Keep your hand in Philemon, okay? We're going back there. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, right after Corinthians. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. See, Paul was saying, hey, this is more than legal. This is from God. It's koinonia fellowship. We're equal. The ground is equal. All debts has been passed away. We all need forgiveness. We're no longer masters. We're no longer slaves. We're now brothers in Christ. That takes priority. Colossians 3:11 says this. Radical verse. This is Paul. In Christ, there is not Greek and Jew. In Christ, there is not circumcision and uncircumcision. In Christ, there is not barbarian and Scythian. In Christ, there is not slave and free. But Christ is all and in all. He's saying there's no humanity, there's no race, there's no gender, there's no social class. We're all equal. We're all partners. That leads us to this terrible word called prejudice. If you allow me a little liberty here, this is not God's word. This is Pastor Griff's interpretation. Paul says in verse 11, in Christ there's not Greek and Jew, circumcision, uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. In Christ there is not different races. In Christ there is not different political parties. In Christ there is not different countries. In Christ, there is not different ages of people. In Christ, there is not different economics. We are all in Christ, in all. Yet we all struggle with prejudice. I encourage you to take the mask off. Each and every one of us are prejudiced about something. You know, I'm prejudiced about people who don't think they're prejudiced, okay? We all have a sinful nature in us. That doesn't mean we give into it. That doesn't mean that we jump into it. But each and every one of us would have something that can bother us. I'm prejudiced about those young guys who think old men are too old to play basketball anymore, okay? That makes me prejudiced. We can be prejudiced of race or gender or social order or finances or political. We got to be incredibly aware of that. We can be prejudiced about cultural. We're all equal at the foot of the cross. And that is what Paul is just telling his buddy today. Man, this guy's no longer a slave. He's wronged you, but we're all equal. We all deserve to be separated from God. You know, what's interesting about this book of Philemon is not one time does it share the story of the gospel. Man, Paul pounded on the gospel in his writing. He was radical about sharing all the teachings of the gospel. Why not in Philemon? It's because he was writing to one buddy who was already saved. But make no mistake, he didn't share the story of Jesus in Philemon, but he showed the story of Jesus in Philemon. Look at verse 15. See if this is Jesus' story. Perceive this is Jesus in you. For perhaps this is why he is separated from you for a brief time, so you might get him back permanently. We're separated from sin, by sin for a short time from God in our life till we receive him. Verse 16, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a dearly loved brother. Okay, we don't come back to God as a slave. I mean, we choose to be slaves, but we are now his child. He is especially so to me, but even more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. Verse 17, if you consider me a partner, accept him as you would me. And if he's wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. Church, can I ask you? What's been charged to Jesus' account? Our sin, our punishment. If he's wronged you in any way or owes you anything, we owe God a punishment for our sin. We deserve to be separated from him. Paul says to Philemon, charge that to my account. Jesus said that to the Father. It is finished. It's been charged to my account. It's over. It's finished. It's done. It's complete. We're no longer a slave to sin, but we're a brother of Christ. Verse 19, Paul says, I write this with my own hand. I will repay it, not to mention to you that you owe me, even your own self. Paul is saying, hey, I'll pay it back. Even though you've been saved, I led you to the Lord, I'll pay it back. Jesus was saying, hey, you ought to forgive that person. Even though I've forgiven you, I'll cover their sins also. Yes, brother, may I have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. We bring joy to Jesus when we respond like Jesus responds. So, we're no longer slaves to sin. We're now brothers in Christ. We're now partners. We're now equal in Christ. Paul says, I will pay his debt. I paid your debt. Paul is acting out like Jesus. That's what we're called to do as believers in Christ. Paul refreshed people. He affirmed believers. He made sure he knew that all people are equal. He led a wealthy man to the Lord, and he led a slave who was running away that could have been in prison all his life to the Lord. In all situations, he said, all people are equal. All people need Jesus. All people need to be loved. All people need to be forgiven. In 1921, Lewis Laws became the warden at the Sing Sing prison in New York. At that time, it was the worst maximum security prison in the world. They caused great harm to the prisoners. They treated them very harshly. When this warden went to this prison, he decided that he was going to do something different, and he wanted to turn it into more of a humanitarian institution. They were still in prison. He asked later what happened. He said, well, truthfully, I owe it all to my wife, Christine. She's buried outside the prison walls. Christine was a young mother when her husband went there as a warden, had three children, and she was warned, don't ever take the children into the prison. Don't you ever go into the prison. She thought, there's no way. We're going to treat these people like family. So the first night they had a prison basketball game. She takes her three little children in and sets them right at midcourt, and she watches the basketball game. She met a prisoner who was mute, and she determined that she needed to learn sign language, so she learned sign language to teach him. Another prisoner was deaf, so she was able to understand and ask and help him understand about Braille. She taught him how to read. That was their testimony to these murderous prisoners. 1937, she was killed in a car accident. 16 years they had been there, and that day the warden didn't show up to work. An assistant warden did, and the prisoners could tell something was wrong. And the next morning, the warden was assistant warden was making his rounds, and he saw hundreds of prisoners standing at the gate of the prison. They had heard that Mrs. Laws had passed away, and they lived 3/4 of a mile down the road, and that's where her casket was at. He saw tears going down the inmate's face, and then he makes this radical statement that challenges all of us. He says, "Okay, men, I'm going to let you go and pay your last respects, but you come back after you go." He opens the prison gates. Not one prison guard went with them. And hundreds of men went and stood in line outside the warden's house to pay their last respect to Mrs. Laws. That night when the assistant warden did bed check, every prisoner had checked back in. Paul ends this story in verse 21 by saying, "I am confident of your obedience, and I'm writing you, knowing that you will do even more than I say." He is saying to Philemon, "Philemon, you're going to do even better than I've told you in Onesimus. You're going to glorify God so much that you're going to do radical things to treat all people as equal. You're going to do radical things to let the gospel of Christ to be shared. You're going to do things that the world are going to stare at you and say, 'We don't even understand.'" Church, that's what God's called us to do as believers. Much more than a government rule, much more than a church duty, we're called to realize we're equal in Christ Jesus. We're hopeless without Christ, but He's done such a radical thing for us. We must, we have to. There is no option but us to treat others by brothers as brothers and to do more than we've ever done before. Pray with me. Oh, perhaps you don't have the love of Jesus in your heart today, and you know He loves you. You know He died for you, but you've never received it. Please hear this. Satan's two biggest lies are you can do it some other time, and you got to get your life in order first. First of all, you'll never get your life in order. That's why you need Jesus. Secondly, we don't know that you have any more time, but we do know you have now. Is today the day that you need to understand the radical, amazing love of Jesus? He did something that nobody could comprehend. He died for you while you are yet sinner. He died for you while you couldn't save yourself. He died for you even though you didn't appreciate it. Today you have the opportunity to be equal with other believers in here. We're not any better than you. But we have Jesus in our life. Jesus is better. Jesus is our Savior. Jesus is who's rescued us. You are invited today to receive Christ. How do you do that? You just say yes to Jesus. You can say yes to Him right there in your seat. "Yes, Lord, I accept your gift of forgiveness. I know I'm a sinner. I can't believe you died for me, Jesus, but I'm so thankful that you did. I don't understand everything about you, Jesus, but I want you as my King, my Lord and Savior. I'm desperate for you." You who just accepted Christ, we welcome you to the family of God. I want to urge you to do a courageous thing when we stand in a moment. You grab a friend or your soulmate or a buddy or somebody with you, and you just come share with Reed or Kurt or I. Say, "I've just given my heart to Jesus." Christian, admit it, we got prejudice in our life. We're sinners. We can't quit sinning, but we can continually ask God to make us more like Him and for us to hate sin And we can make it our goal to have everyone equal at the foot of the cross. There's no more Greek or Jew or slave or master. We're all equal in Christ Jesus. That might mean that God calls you to do something radical in the name of Jesus. Something the world wouldn't understand. Is that you today? Hey, maybe God calls you to join this church. I believe we strive very hard to be a church that tries to love all people. We're not perfect. I think we take us seriously. We would love if God calls you to join us, for you to partner with us and us to partner with you as equals. Hey, we're going to sing a song of worship, and then we're going to share the Lord's Supper together. And it's an important time to be right with God. The Lord's Supper is for believers, and it's for believers who have their life in order. Don't enter into the Lord's Supper with an attitude of mockery to God, of sin is prevalent in your life. Be serious about entering into this time of sharing the gospel through the Lord's Supper. Let's stand on our feet. Let me pray. I'm excited to see what God does. God, I thank you that you are living hope. I thank you for a guy who wrote his heart out to his buddy. I thank you that you have given us this book to encourage us and challenge us to treat all people equal, to love all people, to forgive all people. Lord, I pray you bless this time of invitation. And we love you so much, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. You have freedom to respond how Christ calls you to right now.
My life is yours, and my hope is in you only, 'cause my heart you hold, 'cause you made this sinner holy and in glory. Our praises to you, our Lord Jesus, our Father God. Thank you for bringing us into this place together today. Lord, now as we prepare our minds and as you prepare our hearts to celebrate your Lord's Supper, God, I pray that you would cleanse us. I pray that you would show us, look deep within us and show us areas that we sin. Areas that we are still living in open rebellion to you and to your will and to your ways. God, I pray that as you highlight these sins in each of our lives, individually and corporately, Lord, we confess them to you. God, this is our prayer, that you would give us clean hands, that you would give us pure hearts, that you would do all this work through the power of your Holy Spirit. Let's sing this together.
Juice and pass that. You'll be standing as you get that. Just keep that till the end. If you would do that, we also invite you, if you're a believer in Christ Jesus, to join us. You don't have to be a member of our church. We welcome you as a believer, but this is for those who are believers in Christ Jesus. So as we continue to sing, you receive elements, and then in a moment we will sing. We'll take the elements together. God bless you.
All right, church, let's join our hearts and our voices in this prayer. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh, Spirit, come make us humble. We turn So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another.
Moment, and before we take the Lord's Supper, would you ask the Lord, just mention these words to Him, ask the Lord about prejudice in your life. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Ask Him about unforgiveness in your life and your desire to forgive. And if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Ask Him about treating all people as equals, neither Jew nor Greek or slaves are free, or if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. I've shared this with you many times, but there's been many times in my life when I took of the Lord's Supper that I did it very flippantly and arrogantly. It was just Lord's Supper time. Just a time to do this thing. That is so wrong. This is the changing element of our whole life. It is the hope of the whole world. It separates us from life and death. And it's the greatest gift we can ever receive. As we partake of these symbols, they are not just symbols. They're important, vital, incredibly important symbols that reminds us of what Jesus did for us on the cross. So believers, you give God thanks right now and you take of the bread and eat. This is my body, it was broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Without the blood being sacrificed, there is no forgiveness of our sins. But thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. You take of this juice and remember of the sacrifice of Jesus. Our ushers are going to come right now and we're going to share in our morning offering. If you're our guest, thanks for placing the special guest card in the offering plate this morning. God, I thank you for this time of celebration. Lord, we remember that we're sure not perfect and we definitely need a Savior, but we're so thankful that you've saved us and you've loved us unconditionally. Bless our church, God. Give us clean hands and a pure heart. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Just a few things on our way out this morning. This afternoon, we do have a great event. We have the Oklahoma Baptist Children's Course with us today at 4 o'clock this afternoon. And so, man, you will be blessed if you are here with us this evening and this afternoon. So make sure that you are here with your family. No child care for that event itself, but we'd rather you just have your kiddos with us in worship, and you will not be disappointed of that time of worship this afternoon. There's also in the month of November a couple of men's ministry and women's ministry events. For you women, on November the 15th, there's a string art event. And I've been hearing some really cool things about this event, but all you need is $10, a hammer, and a pair of pliers, and everything else will be provided. So for you women, that's going to be a great time of fellowship with one another. For you men, on Saturday, November the 17th, at 9 o'clock, let me see if I can get this right again, a tour, a breakfast, a devotion, a tour of the Oklahoma Territorial Capital Sports Museum, right? All right. So you men in the room, bring your kiddos for that. That's going to be a good time fellowship as well. Coming up in just a couple weeks, many of you have been asking, okay, what does it mean to be a member of Waterloo Road Baptist Church? How do I get connected? How do I serve? What does that look like for me and my family? November the 18th, there is a connecting lunch, class and lunch, and then you'll find that in the center column of your bulletin. We would love for you, if you have any questions about what we do here at Waterloo or how to become a member, that Sunday is going to be important for you to do so. I'm going to ask Griff to introduce some new folks to us, and we'll end with a video at the closing.
That connecting class, for those of you who've already joined our church, or those of you who just want to find out more about it or close to joining, either way, we hope you'll join us. I want to introduce you to Scott and Jeannie Allen. They'll come up here and stand. Scott and Jeannie have been visiting our church for several months. They've been a part of Lyle Sasser's great Sunday school class, and so glad to have him. They're believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're joining us from a sister church today. Would you welcome them into our church family? Thank you so much. Thank you, Jeannie. Their daughter's connected some with some of our girls who just graduated high school. You come by at the end of this service and greet them. I'm going to ask them to be seated just for a second. We're going to watch a quick 2-minute video about Orphan Sunday, and we'll make that our prayer as we go together. Thank you.
That's always the motivation. It's always Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. So it's not about us rescuing these orphans, but it's about Jesus rescued me. Don't you understand? You and I were children of God, and celebrate that we are no longer orphans. We're loved by this Father. We're in this eternal family, and it's just this overflow of all this joy makes us want, you know, out of a desire, man, I want to rescue these other kids. I want to be able to do a little bit of what God did for me. Look, it's one thing to preach the gospel, but here's an opportunity we have to actually live it out, give them a picture of it. You know, we talk about how, you know, we've been adopted by God. He takes us on as his children. But now we have an opportunity to give the world a picture of that. See, now I'm showing Christ. I'm showing God the Father to other people. So it's all gospel-centered. It's now that I've been telling you about God the Father, let me represent him by what I actually do, by taking these kids into my own home, by loving these children and encouraging other people to do it. Now they see the gospel in action. They've heard and we've taught them, look, God rescued us. And now we're giving them a picture of it. Here's a picture of rescue. I'm doing the same thing God did for me.
Hey, we're all equal at the foot of the cross. Find a way to love somebody this week. You join us in prayer. Treat all people equal, and we are reconciled in Christ. I love you. Have a great afternoon. We'll see you back here later on. Bye-bye.